हेलो। हेलो।
यस मैम।
या ओके कंटिन्यू। Are you able to see the screen? Are
यस
you able
मैम।
to? Okay. Let me continue. So last class, I started with Fourier series, and we all came to know about Fourier series representation of continuous time periodic signals. So that was about module 3, and now I'm going to start with the fifth module, Z transform. So here you are going to study about the Z transform, its properties, and the different analysis which can be made on various signals and systems using Z transform. Okay, so let me start with the introduction to Z transform. As you all know about, I think previously you would have studied about Laplace transform. So I can say Z transform is nothing but discrete type counterpart to the Laplace transform. So what Laplace transform is for the continuous time signal, so Z transform is the same for the discrete time signals. Okay, so actually what is this Z transform? So Z transform is nothing but representing signals using discrete time complex exponential for analysis. Okay, so in Laplace transform, we represent the signal using continuous time complex exponential. So if you remember the Laplace transform, it is if you take x of t, the Laplace transform will be x of s integral of x of t into e raised to minus st. That e raised to minus st is continuous time complex exponential. Now, same thing in for Z transform. For analysis, we represent the signal using discrete time complex exponential. Okay. Now, how is it important? Why is Z transform is important for us? It is used to analyze all the signals and system. That is, you can understand the characteristics of various systems using Z transform. That is one thing. Then, what are the different analysis? Like using Z transform, you can analyze about the causality of a system or stability of a system. Okay, so those analysis, they are some of the examples of analysis. So you can do some more analysis on signals and systems. And one more thing is, so using Z transform, you can implement LTA systems or other discrete time systems on computers. So for implementation, this is useful. So actually, what is this Z transform? So here goes the definition of Z transform. So for any discrete time signal x of n, Z transform is Z of x of n. So if you want to take Z transform of any discrete time signal x of n, we take Z of x of n. And that Z of x of n results in x of Z. So x of Z is nothing but Z transform of x of n, which is equal to summation of n varying from minus infinity to plus infinity x of n into z power minus n. So this is how we take the Z transform of a discrete time signal. Okay, now what is this Z? I just told you signals are represented using discrete time complex exponential. Now, where is that discrete time complex exponential? Yes, it is in Z. So let us see what is Z here. So Z is the complex variable. Now we expand Z. Z is nothing but r into e power j omega. This is what I told. We are representing signals and systems using discrete time complex exponential. And now this is your discrete time complex exponential. So in this, r gives us the magnitude of z and omega gives us the angle of z. Okay. So now, if you substitute for this z in x of z expression, so you get x of in place of z, I have r into e power j omega, which is equal to summation of n varying from minus infinity to plus infinity x of n into what is that? R into e power j omega rise to minus n. Okay. So if you put r is equal to 1 here, so I get x of e power j omega is equal to x of n into e power minus j omega n. That uses the expression for discrete time Fourier transform. So why I wanted to tell that is, so this discrete time Fourier transform and the Z transform is related. So in case of discrete time Fourier transform, you have e raise to minus j omega n. So if you substitute e raise to minus j omega by Z, that will be your Z transform. So as of now, please understand that what is Z transform, why it is important, and how do you find out the Z transform, and what is Z? Z is equal to R into e power j omega. Okay. Now coming to the Z plane. Now in case of Laplace transform, if you remember, you had a plane called S plane. Do you remember? Yes. So any point in X of S was plotted on this S plane. Any point x of s was plotted on the S plane. So this was your S plane, if you remember. So you had sigma and j omega, right? So any point x of s can be plotted on this plane. This we call it as a S plane. Now similar to your Laplace transform, in Z transform we have something called as Z plane. Okay, so in Z plane we have the real axis is indicated as real of Z, and this Y axis is indicated as imaginary of Z. Now any point Z, in any point Z which is equal to r into e power j omega, can be located in this Z plane. So how are you going to locate? Like how you are locating any point in the S plane when s was equal to sigma plus j omega? How you are locating? So what is the sigma value? We'll take this is some sigma value. Corresponding to that, what is that j omega value? And this was the point we were locating. Similarly, in Z plane, Z is given by r into e power j omega, right? So r, what we do from the origin, we take a line whose length is equal to r, and at what angle we are taking this line? At an angle of this omega. So this is how we represent the any point in case of Z plane. So any point Z is equal to r into e power j omega is located at a distance r from the origin and at an angle of omega relative to the real axis. So this is how we locate. Now coming to the relationship between x of n and x of z. So that is given by x of n, x of z. So this indicates, double arrow indicates that x of n is the inverse z transform of x of z, and x of z is the z transform of x of n. They form a z transform pair. I'll talk about inverse z transform in the later classes. Now we just move on towards the z transform. Okay, so this indicates the x of n and x of z form a z transform pair. Okay, now I said that For discrete time signals, you can use the transform for analysis. Now, it is not that when I say you can use the transform for discrete time signal, doesn't mean that for all the discrete time signals, your x of z should exist. That means that for all the discrete time signals, the z transform will not exist. If the z transform has to exist for any discrete time signal, a condition has to be satisfied. Like I told you few conditions in case of Fourier series also. So similarly, for any discrete time signal, if the z transform has to exist, the condition has to be satisfied. So let us see what is that condition. The condition is for the existence of x of z, for the existence of x of z, for any x of n, this summation, what is this summation? This is the z transform equation, right? So this summation should converge. Converge means this summation should give me a value which is less than infinity. Okay, so if any signal that gives me this, only then for that signal the z transform will exist. Otherwise, the z transform will not exist. So here, what I do to get that condition, what we do is we'll substitute for z. What is z? R into e power minus j omega. So now, because I am talking about the value which is less than infinity, so I'll just neglect this phase factor. This is going to give me phase, right? So neglecting the phase factor, I can say the summation of n varying from minus infinity to plus infinity, x of n into r power minus n. This should give me, this should converge. Means this summation has to be less than infinity. Only then the x of z will exist for any x of n. So I can say the range of r, that is the set of all values of r for which this condition is getting satisfied, that we call it as region of convergence. Okay, so the range of r, or the set of all values of r for which this summation converges, we call that as region of convergence. Otherwise, we know that z is equal to r into e power j omega, neglecting e power j omega. So z is equal to r. That means, otherwise I can also say the set of all values of z for which this summation converges, that is called as region of convergence. So this is very important for any discrete time signal to have the z transform. So to understand about the region of convergence in a better way, I have taken few simple examples. So using the simple examples, I'll tell you what is actually this region of convergence. So let me start with, I think here from here you are all clear about what is z transform, that is the equation of z transform. Then what is z is equal to, then what is z plane, what are the axes of z plane, and how any point in the z plane can be located, and what is the condition for which the z transform will exist given any discrete time signal x of n. It is region of convergence. So let us start with some basic examples. So here, given the discrete time signal x of n, we'll try to find out its z transform and we'll check the region of convergence. Okay. So this is the first example. X of n is equal to delta of n. You know what is delta of n? Delta of n is nothing but the unit impulse function. Unit impulse function is defined only at n is equal to 0. And what is, and since the name says it is unit impulse, its value is 1 and it is defined only at n is equal to 0. Otherwise it is 0. Let us find out x of z. So here I take the equation for x of z. X of z is equal to summation of n varying from minus infinity to plus infinity x of n z power minus n. So summation of n varying from minus infinity to plus infinity delta of n z power minus n. You know, if I take delta of n in place of x of n, I don't need this summation because x delta of n is defined only at n is equal to 0. So let me take that. So when n is substituted here, see, n is equal to 0, z power 0, and delta of n is 1. So I get 1 into z power 0 equal to 1. Now you tell me, this summation x of z, as it is, I've got 1. That means the z transform is existing for the given discrete time signal delta of n. So as I told, if I have to find out for what values of z this x of z is existing for x of n, I cannot find values of z because our x of z, we don't have any z term here. So I can say the region of convergence is the complete z plane. For entire z plane means I can take all the values of z for this x of z to converge. Please understand, for any signal x of n, if x of z has to exist, this summation has to be less than infinity. That means, so for what and all values of z, this summation is giving me less than infinity. That is region of convergence. Now for this example, after substituting the given signal, I am getting the summation is equal to 1. That means already it is converged. It is giving me a finite answer. That means what? The region of convergence is the complete set plane. All the values of z will give me this x of z, which is less than infinity. Okay. So let us consider the second example. So here I have taken a shifted version of the impulse. X of n is equal to delta of n minus k. So this is the shifted version. That means what? Your delta of n minus k means, if this is n is equal to 0, this delta of n minus k is 1 at n is equal to k. Okay, so this is n is equal to 0, this is n is equal to k. So when n is equal to k, this delta of n minus k is equal to 1. Okay, so this is the equation of z transform. Let me substitute delta of n minus k in place of x of n. So I get delta of n minus k into z power minus n. So what is delta of n minus k? It is 1. Where? When n is equal to k. So I don't need this summation. So if delta of n minus k is 1, when n is equal to k. So I get 1 into z power minus k, or I get x of z is equal to 1 divided by z power k. So this summation is now reduced to x of z is equal to 1 divided by z power k. Now you tell me, for what values of z this x of z will converge? Yes. So you take any values of z, this x of z will converge. That means this x of z will value will be less than infinity except for z is equal to 0. So you can see from this summation, x of z is 1 divided by z power k. When you take z value as 0, so 1 divided by 0, it gives me infinity. That means all the values of z, for all the values of z, this x of z will converge except z is equal to 0. Okay. Next. The same thing I have extended here. X of n is equal to delta of n plus k. Like how I took previously delta of n minus k. Now I have taken delta of n plus k. So what is delta of n plus k? Delta of n plus k is equal to 1 when n is equal to minus k. That is, it is shifted towards the left side. Okay. So let me substitute here. What is delta of n plus k? It is 1. Where? When n is equal to minus k. So here in place of n, you put minus k. So I get x of z is equal to z power k. Okay. Now think over it. What is the region of convergence for this summation? So any values of z, this summation will converge. That means this will give me less than infinity, but only for one value this doesn't converge, that is except z is equal to infinity. So if I put z is equal to infinity, x of z is infinite. So other than z is equal to infinity, for all other values of z, this will converge. So I can say region of convergence is the entire z plane except z is equal to plus infinity. Now I have taken very simple example here. One more example. So you can see x of n is equal to, I have four samples here, 1, 2, 0 and 7. Okay. So this signal is defined because I don't have arrow below any of these numbers. That means this is defined at n is equal to 0. This is defined at n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2 and n is equal to 3. So now what I do, instead of as per our formula, the summation will vary from where to where? It will vary from minus infinity to plus infinity, x of n into z power minus n. But as per our data, you can see that our data is varying only from 0 to 3. Okay, so I take n is equal to 0 to 3, x of n into z power minus n. So let me expand this summation. So I get x of 0 into z power 0 plus x of 1 z power minus 1 plus x of 2 z power minus 2 plus x of 3 z power minus 3. So let me substitute. So what is x of 0? 1 into z power 0 is 1. Okay, so it is 1. Next, x of 1 is 2. So 2 into z power minus 1 plus 0 into z power minus 2 plus 7 into z power minus 3. So I get 1 plus 2 by z plus 7 by z power 3. Now for this x of z, what might be the region of convergence? Means for what values of z this summation is going to give me an answer less than infinity? Yes, for all the values of z, this gives me a value less than infinity except for z is equal to 0. So for z is equal to 0, it gives me infinity. Okay. So yes. This was the problem which was defined only on the right side. Can you see? It starts from n is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3. So I have taken an example here. So you can see in this example, I have put an arrow below 6. That means what? This is the sample that is existing at n is equal to 0. This is the sample that is existing at n is equal to 1. And this is at n is equal to minus 1, n is equal to minus 2, and n is equal to minus 3. So I can say in the equation of x of z, the index of the summation n will vary only from minus 3 to plus 1. It's not from minus infinity to plus infinity as per this data. It's from minus 3 to 1. Now as per this, we have expanded. Okay. Now after that, we substitute the values of z. So what is x of minus 3? 2 z power 3. Okay. Minus 7, because it is minus 7. Minus 7 into z power 2 plus 4 into z plus 6 plus z 6 plus 1 into z power minus 1, that is 1 by z. Now, what is the region of convergence for this summation? You can see z is both in the numerator and also in the denominator. So I can say this x of z will converge except for two values, that is when z is equal to 0 and when z is equal to infinity. So here if you put z is equal to infinity, it goes to infinity, and because I have 1 by z here, and if I put z is equal to 0, this becomes infinity. So I can say the region of convergence is the entire z plane, that is all the values of z except z is equal to 0 and z is equal to infinity. I think by now you would have understood what is the Z transform and what is the importance of this region of convergence. So for any given signal, if X of Z has to exist, then this summation has to converge. Okay, so if it has to converge, you have to find out for what values of z it is converging. So this is how you find out the values of z. So with these simple examples, you have understood about the region of convergence. Now in general, I'll tell you about the various properties of region of convergence. Okay, so coming to the first property. So first property says ROC of X of Z, ROC of X of Z, region of convergence of X of Z consists of a ring in the Z plane centered about the origin. That means in the Z plane, so if this is your Z plane, this is the real part of Z and this is the imaginary part of Z. It will consist of a ring in the Z plane. So I can say this is the ring in the Z plane centered about the origin. So ROC of X of Z consists of a ring in the Z plane centered about the origin. So these are all the properties of region of convergence. And the second property says ROC does not contain any poles. Okay. Now how do you calculate poles? You know, given any function, like for example, I take here x of z. So if this x of z is defined in terms of z, right? So if you simplify, I'll have polynomials, I'll have polynomial in the numerator and also in the denominator. This you already know. If I solve the polynomial in the present in the numerator, I'll get zeros of the zeros. If I solve the polynomial which is present in the denominator, I get poles, right? So this property says that the region of convergence does not contain any poles. Okay, so this you can understand still better if you take some examples and solve. Okay, now as of now you just understand it consists of a ring in the Z plane centered about the origin and the region of convergence does not contain any poles. The what is the next property? The next property says if x of n is of finite duration, then the ROC is the entire Z plane except z is equal to 0 and z is equal to infinity, or except z is equal to 0 or z is equal to infinity. That means if x of n is of finite duration, that means there are few samples, like I took the previous example, no? Like I can take if x of n is equal to say 1, 2, 3 as an example. So I have x of n with only 4 samples. It is of finite duration signal. Now if you take the Z transform of it and try to find out ROC, then the set of all values of Z for which this X of Z converges is the entire Z plane except Z is equal to 0 and Z is equal to infinity. Okay? If X of N is a right-sided sequence, then the ROC is outside the circle. What is this right-sided sequence? Right-sided sequence, the best example is U of N. You know that U of N is a unit step function which is defined from N is equal to 0 and to N greater than 0 till infinity. So it is not defined for the negative values of N. So it is a right-sided sequence, right? So if X of N is a right-sided sequence, then ROC is outside the circle. Which circle? Go to your first property. It says that ROC of X of Z consists of a ring in the Z plane centered about the origin. So if X of N is a right-sided sequence, then the ROC is outside the outside the circle, means the entire Z plane outside this circle. So in the next examples, I'll tell you how to, the circle means you should have the radius, right? So in the examples, we know how to draw the circle, what will be the radius and how do you decide this. So as of now, understand, if it is a right-sided sequence, then ROC is outside the circle. So this is your region of convergence. That means all the values of Z except the values present in the circle outside. What is the next property? If X of N is a left-sided sequence, the ROC is inside the circle, left-sided sequence. So example, I can say left-sided sequence. If U of N is a right-sided sequence, I can say U of minus N. So U of minus N becomes a left-sided sequence. Yes, it is defined. Minus N is reverse of this, right? So it is defined from 0, minus 1, minus 2, so on till minus infinity. Fine. So if the given sequence is a left-handed side sequence, the ROC is inside the circle. So as from the first property, we know that ROC will consist of a circle with center as origin. So if X of N is a left-sided sequence, then ROC is inside the circle. Means all the values of Z which are inside this circle is your ROC. Okay, then sixth property. If X of N is a two-sided sequence, then the ROC is a concentric ring. Two-sided sequence, that means I can say two-sided is like if I have a sequence X of N, something like this. X of N is equal to U of minus N minus 1 plus U of N. Can you analyze this? U of N is a right-sided sequence from 0 is defined from 0 till infinity. U of minus n minus 1. U of n minus 1, you know, n minus 1 means 1 to infinity. After you take reversal of n, so it will just become mirror image, then it will be defined from n minus 1 to minus infinity. Right? So this X of n is a two-sided sequence. That means it is defined for the entire range from minus infinity to plus infinity. In that case, your ROC will be a concentric ring. How? Your ROC will be something like this. This is the real part of Z, imaginary part of Z. And that this, because it is a two-sided sequence, we get two circles here. And your ROC will be the region which is in between these two circles. That's why we say ROC is a concentric ring. That is, the values of Z which are present in between these two circles. That is your ROC. If X of N is a two-sided sequence. Okay. And the last, if the Z transform X of Z of X of N is rational, then its ROC is bounded by the poles, okay, which you get when you solve this X of Z. Okay, so as of now, I've told you about all the properties of the region of convergence of Z transform. So in the next slides, I'll be showing you the first few examples. I just took very simple examples to tell you the meaning of region of convergence. Now, after knowing the properties of region of convergence, we'll take some examples. That is, examples which are related to these things, whatever is said in the properties. Like if the given sequence is a right-handed side sequence, left-handed side sequence, double-sided sequence, and all that. So in the next class, I'll continue with this. So